I don't know about you, but I have an amazing awareness of the presence of God in my heart right now. And I hope you do too. I want to focus this morning on one verse of Luke chapter 2. Two verses. Verses 4 and 5. Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married with him, married to him, and was expecting a child. Have you ever asked yourself the question, who in the world would take a very pregnant teenage girl on an 80-mile journey, walking, riding on the back of a donkey? What made them go to Bethlehem anyway? Some of the questions like that are the ones that we have. Can you see Joseph saying, well, we'll be back in a couple of weeks? Don't know if he really thought that or what. I don't know anything about the state of obstetrics in that particular time frame, so. I mean, I know now you can just about pick your day and it's going to happen. But things are a little different then. Nevertheless, you know, when the government speaks, we generally listen, don't we? Kind of do what we're told most of the time. The Nativity Story is a movie that came out a couple years ago. And it very dramatically portrays the journey from Nazareth to Bethlehem. And I want us to think about journeys this morning, because we're thinking about multiple journeys. Now, the movie parallels, to some extent, the movement of the wise men to the place where Jesus was to be born. And on that journey, there are hints of things to come. And now, it's a movie. We don't necessarily get our theology from movies. But yet, I think it's a very... I hate to use the word poignant, because everybody used that word, so I'm not going to use that word. It's a very good, one syllable, in my mind anyway, portrayal of what it could have been like. I mean, these are the only words we have. You know, Luke 2:5, it just says that Joseph went from Nazareth to Bethlehem to take part in the census. So it's a lengthy clip, so you might as well get comfortable. Don't get too comfortable so you go to sleep, but get comfortable as we show what they might have experienced.
Rome is requesting a census, each man to return to the place of his birth.
Such an order will lead to unrest. The people whisper of rebellion even now.
It is the will of Caesar. My father lost his life because he failed to see the threat that was mounting against him from his own people. Now, all it will take is one man, to convince the people he is their Messiah. The prophet said this man will rise from the house of David.
This census would bring him back home.
Have your soldiers and your spies keep watch for a man returning to Bethlehem. A man of power. A man the people will follow.
Town of Nazareth! In the name of King Herod and the Almighty Caesar! You are ordered to participate in the census of all people. Each man will return to the land of his ancestors, along with each member of his family.
And what if it's a four-day journey?
Then you would be wise to leave soon.
You have 1 month, and any resistance will be dealt with. Set!
Census can only mean one thing.
More taxes for Herod.
Does that surprise you?
I cannot register here. The order was for each man to travel to the place of his ancestors. I must go to Bethlehem.
But the journey to Bethlehem is more than 100 miles.
I know. For me and for each member of my family.
They will allow her to stay. I cannot expect
They will her allow to... nothing.
Mother, the days before my child comes are greater than those of this journey. There is time.
That is a question for God to decide, not you.
I'm going with my husband.
Then you must leave in the morning. Take the animal.
No, no.
Take it, Jules.
Thank you. I will protect your daughter and the child with all that I am, I promise you.
There is no well before the Sea of Galilee.
Mary, you're a strong young woman.
Thank you, Father.
Go. They're going to miss us.
He's moving. You've never really told me of your dream.
My dream?
No, please. Tell me.
The angel came to me, and he told me the child within you had been conceived by the Holy Spirit, and that I should not be afraid.
Are you afraid?
Yes. Are you?
Yes. Do you ever wonder when we'll know?
No, no one.
When he's more than just a child, will it be something he says? A look in his eye?
I wonder if I will even be able to teach him anything.
Thank you. was good we brought one more camel. But that might be your dinner.
Perhaps we should have brought another. Jenny will be more bearable.
Tell me, Gaspar, how many days has it been since we departed?
104.
And how many of those days have you spoken with regret for having journeyed with us?
105.
Huh?
I'm counting tomorrow.
Aha.
Stop!
Where are you headed?
From Nazareth to Bethlehem.
Bethlehem? Search him.
Go.
Akub.
He's not the one.
Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and endowed with salvation, and his dominion will be from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth. Shall speak peace unto the heathens.
For you.
No.
No, no, for you, for your child.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You carry him like a son. To see yourself in a young face, there is no greater joy.
This threat to my rule, as I will all threats.
Aviti.
Aviti.
Bashati.
Bashati.
Pass your sins onto the animal.
Baruch ata Adoshem, kilokeinu melech haolam, hamotzi lechem min haaretz.
First time in 3,000 years, all three will appear to touch.
You.
Doing your will, I pray you give me a sign.
Joseph. child. You will have a good and decent man to raise you. A man who will give of himself before anyone else.
Jerusalem, the holy city.
Some jewelry for your beautiful wife.
It's a good animal. Would your husband be willing to sell him?
No.
What belongs to us stays with us. This was meant to be a holy place.
Bethlehem, this way. Shepherds, they live alone most of their lives.
Your woman looks cold.
Just for a moment. I will tell our child about you, about your kindness.
My father told me a long time ago that we are all given something, a gift. Your gift is what you carry inside.
What was your gift?
Nothing. Nothing but the hope of waiting for one.
We must go if we're to reach Bethlehem by dark. We thank you.
Now again, don't get all your theology out of a movie. But as we see it there, it's full of dangers, twists and turns, uncertainty, thieves, kindness. But you know, God sends us all on a multitude of journeys. In that journey with Joseph and Mary, we see sometimes the things that we see in our own journeys, because nearly always the journey takes an unexpected turn. Nearly always the journeys take unexpected turns. And that's, isn't that the way most of us would say, or most of the world would say, you know, that's just kind of the way life is. That it takes unexpected turns, and it does. But when we are doing God's bidding in our lives, we still find those unexpected turns. It also reveals an unexpected or maybe an undiscovered strength of character. Have you ever been in a situation where you really were stronger than you thought you were going to be? Have you ever been in a place, particularly in a moment that it seems like everything that had ever happened to you had come together at that moment, at that point, and it was just exactly what you needed and what was needed to take care of the moment? Well, then nearly always the journey that God calls us on sometimes narrowly escapes failure. When we're involved in a project, when we're involved in God's calling upon our life, when we're involved in carrying out the things that He wants us to do, there's a risk of failure, that it will not come to completion. And then also contains disappointments. Did you notice how Joseph was disappointed when he got to Jerusalem, the holy city, and there he had to fight off the thieves, and he had to fight off the marketers, he had to fight off the sellers, just so that he could make his way through the city? And how many times are we disappointed? We're disappointed in other people. We're disappointed in some of the things that we discover about people, that we see. I told my daughters, they worked at Nazarene. We used to call it headquarters. Now it's called the Global Ministry Center. And I used to, and both of them worked there, and I told them for a period of time, I told them, I said, now listen, not everybody there is going to act like a Christian all the time. You're going to see some disappointing things. And just be careful. But also, the journey that God takes us on illustrates oftentimes Acts 14:22. You know what Acts 14:22 says? We don't put it on our advertisements very much. We don't put it on our promotions, because it's the Apostle Paul going back to some of his converts, and it says, strengthening the disciples and encourage them to remain and true to the faith. We must go through many hardships to enter the kingdom of God, they said. The Christian life, life in general, but the Christian life, the life that follows God and seeks His will and desire, has hardships in it. Now, what kind of journeys are we talking about? All kinds. They are the journey, first of all, and most of all, of faith in Christ. The journey to with Christ to live in faith. We call it salvation. That moment when we come to Christ and we say, Lord Jesus, forgive me my sin and accept me as one of your children, we are beginning a journey. And we're beginning a journey of faith, a journey that sometimes includes disappointments, sometimes that risks failure, that takes twists and turns that we never really understood or thought what we were going to be. The same is with the journey of full and total commitment and surrender and sanctification. When we say, not, it's not, it's more than just, God, will you take my sins? God, will you direct my life? It's the journey of a vocation. What are we going to do with our lives? And as I think back on my own life, I think about those moments that when a particular journey began. The journey of ministry began for me when I was 16 years old. Oh, I didn't preach my first sermon for a long time after that, but that journey began when God tapped me on the shoulder and in my heart and said, this is what I want you to do. This is who I want you to be for the rest of your life. And it's not only called to ministry, it's called to whatever we do. Whatever our job is can be a calling of God, can be a vocation, can be an opportunity to bring glory and honor to God in the midst of a corrupt world. Or maybe it's the journey of whether to marry or not to marry. And whom? Now that's a big one. That's a really, really big one. Or the journey of trials. Physical trials, spiritual trials, persecutions, financial trials, setbacks, twists and turns, changes in the life that God has called us to live in faith with Him. We're all called. The journey of aging and mortality. Seth, when somebody's going to add their ages and somebody else's ages and say, that doesn't quite come up to what you got. And the final journey home. God calls us and takes us on a multitude of journeys. Now, often the unexplainable human events that we find ourselves in may be the outworkings of a divine agenda. But our part is to make the journey in confidence that Jesus is with us. And He is guiding us. And He is helping us. And He is showing the way. And that He will never leave us nor forsake us as we live in obedience to Him. He said, I will never leave you or forsake you as you live in obedience to me. And so we're on multiple journeys. Many of them, different aspects. And perhaps one of our journeys today, or one of your journeys today, is at risk. Perhaps you feel alone on your particular pathway. Perhaps it's the journey of drudgery. Perhaps it feels like you're going uphill all the time. And maybe your journey is just kind of flat. And maybe today there's an aspect of your journey where you need encouragement. Maybe there's an aspect of your journey that you would like to bring to God and say, Lord, help me on my journey that you have brought me on. To remember that I'm not alone, to remember that you have promised and that you are with me. And that you will bring to completion all that you have started. That's the promise of Philippians. God will bring to completion all that He has started. We're going to close the service this morning again, singing a song. Seth, would you and the folks come? And would you all stand together with me? As we sing our closing song this morning, I would just want you to think about your journeys. The journeys that you are on right now. And maybe if there's a part of it that you just want to say, God, I want to talk to you about it. Or I want to lay it down at your feet again. For the 15th time, I'm going to lay this thing on the altar. You're certainly welcome to come as we sing together.
Paint the night
you count the stars and you call them by name, the skies proclaim, God, you reign.
Your glory shines. You teach the sun when to bring a new day. Creation sings, God, you reign. God, you
Father in heaven, today, as we have been in this place, we have sensed your presence, and we just want to remind you again that we are yours. Our journey is the journey that you have called us to and that you have led us in. So God, today we surrender ourselves to you once again. We ask, God, that where there are trials, that you would bring strength. We ask, Lord, where there is difficulty, that you would bring patience. We ask, God, where there is defeat, that you would bring victory. We praise you today for the leadership of the Holy Spirit in our lives. We praise you that as we make our way, we are not alone. You go with us. And we bless you and thank you today. And Lord, for these that have that are kneeling before you at this altar, you hear their prayer. You meet their need. And you come to their side. We love you today, dear Father. We glorify and we honor the name of Jesus. And Lord, as we make our way back to our homes today, we pray your safety and your help and blessing in all that we do. In the precious and wonderful name of Jesus. And all people said, Amen. God bless you.